days.
I've been here a lot longer than you have.
There on you, and then you need to. From South Dakota Public Broadcasting, this is Dakota Midday for Thursday, June 27, 2013. I'm Carl Gehrke, and today we're coming to you from our studios at the University of Sioux Falls. This weekend is the annual reunion of crew members and their families from the World War II battleship, the USS South Dakota. In preparation of the reunion, the warship memorial in Sioux Falls has been getting a facelift, and we'll hear more about the history of the battleship's exploits in the Pacific, along with what's happening at the reunion. Also joining the show is South Dakota, is a South Dakota native who could be the next wild guide for a new online version of Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom. Stephanie Arne, who is currently a wildlife educator at the Honolulu Zoo, is one of three finalists for the job, and she's brought along some special creatures to join us as well. And if you'd like to see all of this, today's show is video streaming live. Just go online to sdpb.org/live. That's all coming up on today's Dakota Midday, but first the news. I think I'll be fine. I don't know how to get this thing to stay in my ear.
Probably park in the.
I sent her your email instructions. The last I heard, she was on 12th Street.
Okay, great.
I think so. Did that go over the air? What we just did?
Yeah. But their mics were open too, so that's all right. We're good.
Okay.
All is good.
All is good. All is calm.
As tight as you can get. As tight as you can get. Okay. Oh. Glad that you figured out that.
Is that pronounced jerky? Jerky construction?
Yerky.
Yerky.
Vermillion.
Oh.
Yeah, that's our headquarters.
Okay, so talking down there, okay.
Yeah. That's normally where I am. That's where I usually do the show.
Oh, you, okay.
Yeah.
Well, I kind of thought
you
so.
Live in Vermillion?
Yeah.
Well, that's why all this is new to you.
Yeah, this is all, yeah. That's why we're kind of, what's going on here? Kara? Well, you know, at the end, will I get like any sort of 1 minute or something like that in my headphones so I know, or towards the end of the...
The whole hour?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I can see the clock, but I can't, there's no second.
That's not what you said. Well, I could tell you that interviewer, the person. Well, you just talk about what you know.
Well, you
know a lot.
Well, I know, but I don't always think about it at the tip of my tongue. I have my senior moments lately.
Yeah, I know all that goes. From 1969, and when it was first opened.
Welcome to Dakota Midday on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Carl Gehrke, and today we're coming to you from the University of Sioux Falls studios. And coming up, we'll talk with a South Dakota native who is a finalist to become the new wild guide for a new version of Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom, Stephanie Arne. And she's brought along some special friends for us to meet. And if you'd like to see them, today's show is video streaming live. Just go online to sdpb.org/live. But first, during the Battle of Guadalcanal during World War II, the USS South Dakota fought in a battleship duel with the Japanese. 38 crew members were killed, and the Japanese thought they sunk her, but the battleship survived, destroying 64 enemy planes and earning 13 battle stars by the end of the war. After the Navy announced that it was scrapping the battleship, a number of state residents got together to save parts of the USS South Dakota. The memorial was dedicated in Sioux Falls in 1969, and over the past few weeks, it's been getting something of a facelift in preparation for this weekend's annual reunion for crew members and their families. With us to talk about the USS South Dakota and the memorial and the reunion is Karen Dunham. She's a Sioux Falls realtor who's been involved with every USS South Dakota reunion from the beginning. Karen, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Also with us is retired Navy Captain Diane Diekman, who's on the board of directors for the USS South Dakota Battleship Memorial in Sioux Falls. She's also the Master of Ceremonies for Saturday's event at the memorial in Sioux Falls. And Captain Diekman, thanks for being here as well.
Good afternoon.
Well, Karen, to begin with, the reunion's been going on since what, 1969?
1969 is when we had the dedication, and then in 1970 would be the first reunion. And every 2 years after that, I think they might have had 1 year where they had a direct without the two-year period, but we've had everyone since then, and I've been at every one of them, and I've been the local registration person, so I'd help meet and greet and do the local footwork that we needed to do here.
So you must have had over the years the opportunity to meet many of the crew members.
I have. I've met a lot of them, and they've become a lot of good friends, and still communicate with some of them. The one that I communicate with the most isn't able to be here this weekend, and he's the one that made the souvenir clock for me out of the teakwood that I showed you and things. So it's nice that we have good relationships and friends, and it's amazing how they have bonded, even though they were gone so many years from each other, that people just meet the first time, they just have that bond from being in the service back then.
And how many crew members of the USS South Dakota are still alive and still able to come to Sioux Falls for your meetings?
According to Kathy, who is the daughter of Larry Mayday, who was on the ship. She is the second generation that keeps track of the newsletter and the website and things. She said she has 345 that are on the newsletter information list, so she's thinking that's about the number. But they are all, I'd say, over 85 to 88, and so they're not able to travel as much as they'd like to and things like this. This year we have 12 of them coming, two of them for the first time, and one of them there has passed away, but his children are coming. And they've never, their dad never talked about the ship, what his duty was on there, and they're coming here to find out from the crewmates what they can tell him about him.
Well, Captain Diekman, how unusual is that for World War II veterans to want to talk? It's my understanding that oftentimes many of them didn't want to talk about it, and some, as they've gotten older, have started to talk a little bit.
It takes a long time. Some of them, it takes like 50 years or so before they're willing to talk, and it often takes an event or something that opens the floodgates and they're willing to talk. I interviewed a World War II veteran last year who had been in the Battle of the Bulge, and I was the first person he had ever told his story to. So it varies, but many of them die without ever having said a word about their service.
Well, what was that experience like, talking with a veteran who never talked about the experiences before? How do you get them to open up for the first time?
Well, sometimes they finally become ready. I think it takes someone that they have to feel this person is interested and cares and truly wants to hear the story and have some kind of empathy, some kind of understanding that whatever they say will be well received.
Does it help that you served as well?
I think so. We talk a lot of the same language. I think that helps.
Well, Karen, going back to 1969, how did the Sioux Falls Memorial get put together here? I mean, what was it? The ship was being scrapped, and some residents decided, hey, we need to save this parts of it anyway, and have it here in the state.
That's correct. There was a number of local business persons that were involved in that, and I'd say the person that was the lead charge in that was Captain Evans Nord, who was one of the owners of Callow at the time. And he was the one that continued to get the information out to people and raise the funds and went to the governor for the money and stuff like that. And like I said, it was a lot of community support to get it here.
And how much of the original warship is here in Sioux Falls, in 12th and Kiwanis, correct?
Well, she can probably tell you more than I can. I can tell you that the ship is the exact outline of the size mm-hmm. of the ship. I can tell you that we have several gun barrels there. I know we have a lot of the crew members would come back. Like, for instance, 2 years ago, one crew member came back, put his uniform on, and then left it here. But he's not coming back this year.
Yeah, Captain Diekman, how much of the original ship can people see?
The guns and some of the equipment is inside that is on view. There are some parts that are still in storage because they're too big that they don't fit in the memorial. But in general, it's to give you an idea of the size of the ship by having the outline outside. And then inside the memorial are many, many pictures and like the original silver service that the initial captain was presented with, and various things like that. A lot of the members have brought their memorabilia, and some of that is on display. So it's a lot of little things. It gives you the feel of it, but it's nothing like walking through a ship.
Now, the USS South Dakota, how long was it in service?
It was commissioned in March 1942 at the height of the war, and was active for the next several years, and up until the end. It was in Tokyo Bay at the end of the war, and by that time the ship had, as you'd mentioned, called Battleship X. It was reported sunk, and it kept coming back again, and it was the most decorated battleship. It was also, at the end of the war, Admiral Nimitz had flown in from Hawaii and Guam, where he had been where he had his headquarters, and he made it his flagship. And then when the surrender came, as we all know, that took place on USS Missouri, which just happened to be the home state of the President of the United States. So the story is that President Truman preferred the Missouri over the South Dakota, so it did not host a surrender. But it was definitely there for those entire 3 years of the war, three, 4 years.
Now, why was it, now after the war, it was it out of commission, or what? Because it only, what, 5, 6 years?
It was in 1947 that they took it out of service, and, well, the country didn't have a need for battleships anymore.
Now, one of the interesting parts of the history of the U.S. South Dakota was a notable crew member by the name of Calvin Graham. Now, he was, what, 12 years old?
Yes. I first heard of him when the movie came on TV in something like 1987 called Too Young the Sailor. And Ricky Schroeder was this adorable young sailor, and watching that movie just tore me up. He was so, he was in the Battle of Guadalcanal, and he got injured. He was a gunner, and he got injured during the battle, and later on, the movie shows him calling his sister and saying, I have my set of orders. I'm so excited about my next set of orders, and he didn't know that he was carrying these sealed orders that said send him to the brig, because they threw him in the brig for underage enlistment, so he spent his 13th birthday in the brig. And I had to get in touch with him after that, and he lived down in Fort Worth, Texas, so we talked on the phone a few times and exchanged letters, and he had struggled all those years to get his medals back, and he'd been in the Marine Corps after that also, and it took Secretary of the Navy Dalton's involvement to get his medals back and his benefits and such. And then I don't remember what year he died, but it was an amazing story to think of this 12-year-old who joined the Navy, and then the Navy rewarded him by throwing him in the brig.
So how does a 12-year-old get in the military?
By falsifying his mother's name and signing.
Did he look mature for his age?
apparently, I mean, it was not at all uncommon for there's even an organization of underage military in all the services. There were quite a few kids 12 to 15 years old who somehow passed themselves off as being older and were combat sailors and soldiers during the war.
Well, Karen Dunham, did you ever meet him?
Yes, we did. He came to at least one of our reunions, because they usually held him on the 4th of July, and one 4th of July we were fortunate to shoot fireworks with him and his wife Mary and spend the day with them and things. It was interesting to talk to him, because he was, at that time he was still fighting for his benefits and things like that. And it's one of those things that there's a lot of people back in that era, I think, that needed the money for the people at home, because his mother was widowed, if I remember correctly, and they had like 7 children. And so there's a lot of young men that needed the income to support their families back home that went into service, like you were talking about, you know, and things like that. So,
the stories of Calvin Graham and the others who served on the USS South Dakota, why is it important for us to remember and to know these stories?
We don't want these people to be forgotten. They all serve their country. It's history. History goes on, and it's heartwarming to hear some of the stories of the different people and the contributions that they have made. And it hurts to know when they've been mistreated, and it's great to see when they're rewarded and remembered for what they have done.
Mm-hmm. Well, Karen, what does it mean for you to help with the reunions and to meet these veterans and to hear some of their stories?
Well, the first few years I was wearing my uniform, because I was a yeoman second class in the Reserve Center out here for a few years and things. And so being a military person, I've always respected the military. And all of the gentlemen that come back with their families, you know, they brought 17 people sometimes, just to be sure that everybody knows that this is what they're about. And it's just been great getting to know all of them, and it's sad that this part is coming to an end because it's been going on for so long, but they're just great people to know.
And for the families, for the children, and I imagine grandchildren, important for them to know what their fathers and grandfathers did?
It is, because a lot of them, you know, they have the second generation, which is the children and grandchildren, and that of the servicemen that were on the ship. And so they have a real bonding, I think, too, and they have an interest in knowing what grandpa did or whatever and stuff. And so it's very rewarding for them to understand what grandpa was about.
For the veterans that come, how often, are they very talkative at this point,
mm-hmm.
about what happened, about their memories, fond memories, I imagine, despite the danger and that, you know, people were killed, but that still maybe there's a camaraderie and a bond that keeps them together?
Well, they don't talk to me so much about it because mm-hmm. we're more in the casual conversation
yeah.
side. They go over and talk to their buddies and I'm sure tell the stories of the remember when's type of thing and stuff, but they're very open, they're all very caring, they're all very appreciative. You know, they're just happy to be back here, and they just love to go through the memorial and see what's there and to think that they were part of it.
Well, Captain Diekman, looking at the history of the USS South Dakota, how does it fit in to the history of World War II? You mentioned the most decorated battleship during the war.
It was definitely a force to be reckoned with during the war in the Pacific and the battles of Guadalcanal and the wresting the Solomon Islands away from the Japanese. And of course, aircraft carriers were taking over glamour and success. A battleship could no longer win a war, so it became more of a supporting force, but it was certainly still an important force, and it was right up there in the thick of things until the end of the war.
What I find interesting in reading about the USS South Dakota is how much damage it, you know, how you know, was it kept, you know, how what it went through, how much damage it had.
They
to,
are made to absorb.
Yeah, they're made
damage.
To absorb the damage, and it just kept, because there was time when it had to go back and be repaired and spend some time in the other theater.
Right, it did. It went over to Europe for a while, but most of the time was in the Pacific.
Talking about the reunion this weekend, Karen, what will happen? What can people expect who are interested in attending?
Well, the itinerary on a quick note is tonight at 5 o'clock I'm going out there to start registering the early arrivals, and they will meet and greet as they come in. I'll be out there again tomorrow at 9. And then tomorrow is kind of a casual day for them, but Saturday is their big day. At 10 o'clock the band concert starts over at the battleship site. And then at 11 we're going to have a program which Captain Diekman will be the MC for us, and we'll honor those that have passed away since our last reunion, and have some other portions of the program in commemorative of the them coming back here and things like that. And it's just local people are invited to attend. We usually have a great service out at the battleship there. And one thing about it is it's hopefully a way to get people from Sioux Falls out there, because not everybody has been there, and they should, as long as it's been there and for what it has to offer.
And as I mentioned, in preparation for this weekend's event, Captain Diekman, some work kind of fixing it up a little bit. What's been going on?
Well, for months now, periodically it needs to be repainted and dressed up some. So for months now, Robert Ruff has been running a volunteer effort to do that, and he's had a lot of help from the Gehrke Construction Company and other places around town that have donated materials and time to help refurbish the exterior and make it look sparkly and pretty for this weekend.
Okay, so those efforts still ongoing or done?
They're pretty much finishing up, and then later we'll be tackling the inside. We're planning to have some curating done and put some new displays up on the inside, and we're hoping to have that done for next year to show a new interior, perhaps for 2014.
Well, Captain Diekman, thanks so much for taking the time to join us on Dakota Midday. And Karen, thanks for stopping by as well.
You're welcome. Thank you. Glad to be here.
Retired Navy Captain Diane Diekman is on the board of directors for the USS South Dakota Battleship Memorial in Sioux Falls. She's also Master of Ceremonies for this weekend's event. Karen Dunham has been involved with every USS South Dakota reunion of crew members and their families since the beginning. And this year's reunion takes place on Saturday. It begins at 10 o'clock with a band concert there at the memorial site in Sioux Falls. You're listening to Dakota Midday on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Carl Gehrke. We're broadcasting from the University of Sioux Falls studios, and coming up after a short break, we'll meet Stephanie Arne, who's a finalist to be the new wild guide for a new version of Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom, and she's brought along some special guests, and you can see them. We're video streaming today's show online at sdpb.org/live. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. Hi, Stephanie. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. What do you got there?
Yes, snake.
All right.
I'm in charge of the snake.
You're the snake handler?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a snake?
I have a snake.
I have shoes like that.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Are you going to stand?
Thank you. Nice to meet you. So what are we doing here? We're going to stand?
I think that's fine.
Oh.
As long as you can walk over and grab it, yeah.
All right, yeah. We're going to have a camera follow.
Yeah, the camera's going to follow you wherever you go.
Okay.
Should we get rid of these chairs if you want to sit and lean or what?
Yeah, leave them there just in case.
Are we standing here or? And am I on the radio?
So standing, no stools, correct?
Okay.
So they don't.
No, we're going to leave two just in
leave
case.
Two? Okay.
Just in case the standing gets.
Carl.
So these are Tim. Tim works for Wildlife Encounters Animal Rescue in Gretna, Nebraska.
Okay.
He's the one that provided me all of these animals, and he's been touring with me and giving me all these. So.
Okay.
What, Carl? What are you willing to hold?
What's that?
What are you willing to hold?
I'll hold anything.
Okay, great. Okay. He's willing to hold anything. Yeah.
I'll just follow you. I'll follow you guys.
Okay.
Okay, here we go.
Welcome back to Dakota Midday on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Carl Gehrke, and we're coming to you from the University of Sioux Falls studios today. We're also video streaming today's show, so you can go online to sdpb.org/live. Stephanie Arne grew up in Pierre and always felt connected to nature, but she was planning on graduating from South Dakota State University with a degree in human development when she saw a flyer announcing a for-credit 3-week trip to Africa. She went on the trip, and when she got back, she was convinced she belonged alongside wildlife rather than in a counselor's office. Today, she's a wildlife educator at the Honolulu Zoo, and in late May, she was notified that she was one of three finalists to become wild guide on a new online version of Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom, and she's back in South Dakota, and she joins us here in the studio. And Stephanie, thanks for coming on the program.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
And in just a bit, we'll meet some of these special friends that you brought with
you.
Yeah,
they are definitely special.
special
That's right.
And if you want to see them again, we're online at sdpb.org. Well, first of all, the Mutual of Omaha hosting position, when did you first hear about this?
You know, I think it was in March. I think, and I'm currently living in Honolulu, Hawaii, and I was already working towards creating a local TV show, so I had found myself a cameraman and a producer, and we were starting to work on small vignettes, and I was telling my old coworker that, because I started off at the Omaha Zoo, I was telling Julie Anderson about it. What are you up to? I'm like, oh, I'm working towards creating this local TV show. I love it. I'm so excited. It's going to be a long process, though, but I'm in for the long haul. She goes, oh, that's great. Not even 2 days later, calls me back. Hey, Steph, so remember when you were talking about this old TV show thing? I was like, yeah, you've been talking about this for a long time. Like, how bad do you want it? Like, pretty super bad. She goes, well, just so you know, boom, check your Facebook. So I'm on the phone, I look at my computer, and I see my Facebook, and she has tagged me in a post for Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom's new wild guide contest. And I just stared at the computer like, is this a joke? Like, are you serious? And she goes, no, can you believe this? You were just talking about this, you know, and you have been for years, and now they're holding a contest to look for their new host. And I just, seriously, I was blown away. Like, oh my gosh, this is seriously happening. So I watched the advertisement, which is about a 1 minute clip, talking about how they're looking, they're coming back, it's their 50th anniversary, they want to come back with a bang, but doing it a little bit differently. Instead of it being a TV show, they want it to be webisodes. And, you know, use all the social media to connect with the fans, but also to share all these clips all around the internet, all around the world. And they're looking for a wildlife rock star. And, like, that was what they did. It was, like, this guy with this funky haircut. And he's like, wah! And I go, that's me! But, you know, a little bit more masculine there. But, yeah, from that point on, it's been a three-month journey. You know, it's been a while.
So you had to do an audition?
So,
and,
yes.
And it was voted for online?
Yeah, well, we had to create a two-minute video reel. And this was our audition clip. So we did it through YouTube. Gave it to the Mutual of Omaha website, and they showed all the world. Here's every single video.
So worldwide?
Worldwide. About 400 people applied for it. They limited it down to 218 that qualified. And of those 218, they had a judging criteria, and they picked 12 out of the 200. I think it was 218 or something like that. And those 12 became the semifinalists. Then this is when it starts getting crazy, because we have 12 people all fighting to get votes. We could get a vote every day from each person on multiple devices, so every day we were exhausted. We're like, everybody vote for me, and that's not really like, I think a lot of us, we're not that type of person to be like, pick me, but you really had to put yourself out there, because at the end of the game, they added our video total with our public voting score, and the top three closest to 100 became the top three finalists. And I don't know how this happened, but I got picked as one of the top three finalists, along with two other folks, one from Omaha and one from originally Brazil, but currently lives in Texas. So now the process was a waiting game, and then we got flown into the mainland, or we got flown to Omaha, excuse me, to do our interview and our audition, which was a two-day process.
So you've done that?
I did that last Thursday and Friday. Wow. So Thursday was my interview. I was at a huge table with like 15 people all just staring at me. Thankfully, they're Midwestern people. They're my people.
Yeah, so you can relate to them.
They were so kind, so different than the producers I've met in LA and in Hawaii, but so down to earth. It was a conversational interview. So really chill. We're eating salmon. Everybody's talking with their food open, their mouth open, with full of food. Just really relaxed. It was great. And then the next day, I had an audition, and they filmed a five-minute clip of me teaching about penguins. Some of it was scripted, some of it they wanted me to interview somebody, and then the other part was saying, okay, go, just talk about whatever, and just seeing what I could come up with myself. So once that was done, I was like, phew! And it was so much fun. That was probably, up to this point, the coolest day of my life.
And now it's waiting?
How's the waiting game?
Okay, so how does that feel? Just kind of.
I'm so excited. I feel pretty confident. Regardless of if I win this or not, I feel as though that this is my career path. Either way, this is what I was meant to do, and I'm going to continue doing that. I'm very lucky, where this is already my career. I already get to travel around the world and teach people about animals in many different facets. So I'm just going to keep doing what I do.
Yeah.
And if I do get it, of course I'm going to be ecstatic, and it will be a huge dream that will be accomplished. So it's kind of I'm more excited than I am nervous, believe it or not.
Well, I was interested in reading your biography when you were at South Dakota State University, where you were going to go into counseling, human development, and then you saw this flyer that about going to Africa, and this was more or less just something that you decided, I've always wanted to go to Africa, I'm going, and that's when everything opened up for you. Finally, you could see what it was you were supposed to do.
Yeah, it was kind of like Aladdin was like, I can show you the world. It was like I got there, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. I planned to be, I knew it was going to be some form of teacher. All the time growing up, I knew that, but I had always wanted to teach about animals, and obviously I had a few people along the way that were very discouraging. They're saying, oh, you know, to do that, that's dangerous, you know, you're a girl, you'd have to leave South Dakota. I heard everything. You have to be super smart. I was like, what? I heard it's very competitive, but I was like, you guys clearly don't know me, because I did have a couple little instances where I was weak, and I didn't go exactly what I wanted to go for. But thankfully, the degree that I did get in human development and family studies and psychology and sociology was something I was good at and I did like and I did know very well. And I knew it was going to help me in some way, shape, or form. And as soon as I got that, I found out that, wait a second, I can do what I want with the degree I have because zoos have education departments. And then I took an unpaid internship for the summer at Henry Dorley Zoo. And once I got there, I was like, this is what I want. It reminded me so much of Africa. Like, when I was there, it was just surrounded by people that were fascinated with animals. They loved teaching about them. And when I got to this zoo, it was those people. They were fascinated with animals. It was like my kind of people. Uh-huh. And I'm like, yes. And I was just connecting all the dots. I'm like, this is where I'm meant to be. But Africa definitely opened my, wow. I got there and I'm like, there, the world is so not what I thought it was. It's not as dangerous and terrifying as scary as the people had made it out to be for me. And you know what? I made it. I was there for 3 weeks. I survived. I could handle the heat. I could handle the bugs. And the people, the culture blew my mind. So I'm like, this is what I want to do. I want to teach in zoos. I want to teach out in the world. I want to meet all these amazing, fascinating people. And if I can connect teaching with doing that at the same time, then I have the best life in the world.
And since then, you've been, what, Philippines, Australia,
New Zealand? Let's see, Japan, Thailand, Malaysia, which I spent most of my time in Borneo, Malaysia, and Australia, New Zealand, and Africa. Yeah, a bit addicted.
Well, we're gonna meet the creatures in just a minute. We're gonna take a short break.
Okay.
Here. You're listening to Dakota Midday on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Carl Gehrke. Our special guest is Stephanie Arne, originally from Pierre, currently wildlife educator at the Honolulu Zoo, and she's one of three finalists to become wild guide on a new online version of Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom. So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Okay.
It is hot. Whatever one you want to start with. Okay.
Just cut me off.
So we've got about 20 minutes. Will that give us time?
Yes.
And if you want to, I'm going to mic him up just in case. I think you're convinced him to want.
Yeah, just okay. In case he asks me something. I've done a couple shows with these animals. It's just personal questions about him I might not know. So okay. I might look at, is that okay if I'm like,
I'm with my partner.
I'll introduce him, his voice. And, you know, if you hear Tim jump on, he's just going to answer a few questions, so I'll let them know.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
I told her when we got into this, I'm like, I was in the contest as well. Can't beat them, join them. Sort of deal.
Welcome back to Dakota Midday on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Carl Gehrke, and we're coming to you from the University of Sioux Falls studios. And we're also video streaming at sdpb.org/live. And with us in the studio is Stephanie Arne. She's from Pierre. She went to SDSU, and she's currently a wildlife educator at the Honolulu Zoo. And she's one of three finalists to become wild guide on a new online version of Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom. She's back in the state after meeting with the show's producers in Omaha. She's with us here in the studio. And you brought some special guests with you. And who do we have here?
All right. So I have a little chunk of bark with about 8 cockroaches. These are Madagascar hissing cockroaches. And they get that name because...
So you just touch them and they hiss. I don't
know
if the mic can pick that up, but there they are.
Can you hear it? Carl, if you just go.
You just get
it's pretty much what they sound like. So So they make that noise because it's a little bit of a defense for them. If another animal is coming close, if another animal comes close and they don't want to be eaten, then what they're going to do is they're going to stand up really tall, look super big, and they're going to release air that's being stored in their body here. You see these little holes? They have holes on the back part of their thorax and abdomen, and these holes as soon as they get threatened, they'll squeeze everything and it'll release air out of it. And when that happens, it hisses and then they sound scary. So then animals are like, whoa, you look much bigger than I thought. And now you're making this weird noise. Makes them sound very intimidating, hopefully helping give them a few seconds to run away and hide from their predator.
Now these are bigger than the cockroaches we know.
These are much bigger, I would say.
Size of a thumb. Is my thumb anyway?
Yep, the size of Carl's thumb. Bigger, so they're quite huge. They have a black and orange and yellowish tint to them. And they have these weird black hoods that go over them. Now, as you can see with the females, it's a flat hood right by their head, and the males have two little horn-looking things on the top of their hood. Now, they're an insect, so they have six legs, not like a spider that has eight, and two long antennae that they use to discover and explore their environment. Most of the time, they're using those to look for food. And these animals are really important to the planet because they eat all organic material. They compost. They help do all that kind of stuff. So they're keeping the earth clean. So they're eating dead, rotting material, whether it was a living, like an animal, like a mammal that's rotting, or sometimes they'll just eat organic detritus, like organic leaves and dirt and worms and all that kind of stuff. So they're very, very helpful for their environment.
I'm assuming that because they're Madagascar hissing cockroaches, that's
they're
where
they're from.
They're from Seattle.
No, they are. They are from the island off the east coast of Africa. It's called Madagascar. And what's really cool about Madagascar is everything that's there is only found there. It's really neat. I mean, maybe some birds can travel around a little bit, but a lot of animals are only found there, and that means they're endemic, only found there. So it's a really unique place because you have all these crazy animals like lemurs. You might be familiar with lemurs. Uh-huh. They look like a monkey, but they're a prosimian that has the black and white striped tail that goes, oh, I like to move it, yes. In that cartoon. Yeah, that's where we're at right now in the world. It's a really special creature.
All right, what else do we have here?
All right. You grab that. So I just wanted to give you a heads up in the process that I'm here with a partner of mine. His name's Tim Davison, and he's kind of my bud. He's been really helping me out. He is from Wildlife Encounters, which is a nonprofit wildlife animal rescue center based out of Gretna, Nebraska. And he's been assisting me on this tour by providing me some of his rescued animals, like this
tarantula.
Golden knee tarantula. And this is different from the cockroaches because he has eight legs, not six. And he is an arachnid. Now, what's really cool about this tarantula is that he has different types of defense. Okay, you ready? You want to hold him
first, then we'll talk
about them.
And he'll defend himself, and how do I defend myself?
I'll tell you in just a moment. Let's get him on
Let's
you
get him on
first,
me
and then I'll tell you how to protect yourself. So just stay calm.
There we go.
And if he starts to move, then you can just move your hands with him. If you do that, yeah.
He's climbing up my shirt.
He's gonna climb up your shirt.
I'm not a tarantula wrangler.
That's okay, but you got him on. Yeah. Now just stay calm and he'll stay right there. Perfect. Okay, so the ways that he protects himself. Number one, obviously he has really long fangs. He is venomous.
Tell me that now.
Yes. Now if he were to bite you, which he's not gonna bite you today, because you're not threatening him, you're not going to try to step on him or eat him, and he knows that. He can feel
well,
that.
I haven't had lunch, though.
Well, you know what? Some people do eat these around the world, but we're not going to do that today, Fred. Okay. This is Fred the tarantula.
Hi, Fred.
And so he's not going to use his fangs and bite you, but if he were to, it would be comparable to a bee sting. This specific species of tarantula doesn't have a venom that would kill you. So it's just like a bee sting, so no worries. You've had that happen before, right?
Sure.
Okay, but don't worry. It's not going to happen. If something is too big for him and he doesn't want to get too close, then he's going to pull these little hairs that he has on his body off of his body and float them into the air. Now, they're really light, so they float around just like any other particle in the air, but they're a little bit sharp. And if it's a predator that's getting super close, that means its eyes, nose, and mouth are exposed. And because these little hairs are going to stick to the wet part, right? So the hairs will come up and stick in the nose, the mouth, and the eyes, making that animal go, cough and sneeze. Hopefully it gets the hair out. But if it gets in the eyeball, it embeds in the eyeball, and it feels like a scratchy contact for the rest of your life. Even to this day, modern doctors have not, like eye doctors, have not found a way to cure that or to fix it or get it out of the
eye. I'd rather be stung.
Yeah, I think, I know, isn't that true? Yeah. So fortunately, in his case, he doesn't feel threatened, so we're really lucky. And you can see here that he does have hair throughout his entire body, so what will happen is, well, he has hair in his body, and it's attached to his exoskeleton, so he doesn't have vertebrae and bones like you and I do. That exoskeleton holds everything that's inside in place. But as he grows, because he will get bigger, as he grows, he molts, just like a snake sheds its skin. Now, when he molts, it looks exactly the same as he does right here. So what he does is it'll kind of detach from his body, and underneath, just like a baby tooth is growing under an adult tooth, it'll start to form. Then when he's ready, he'll pop off this top part here. You see that?
Mm-hmm.
He'll pop it off. He'll pull all of his eight legs in and squeeze into a tiny bowl, and then he will step out of his molt, leaving an exact replica of his body. And there's times where I'll just take the molts around.
You see that.
And I'll take the molts around, and people are like, ah! Like, it's not even real. And they get confused, like, is it dead? No,
it's just not there.
It's just a shed.
It's just a shirt.
Yeah. So this particular tarantula, he's probably around 5 or 6 years old, which is pretty old for a male golden-kneed tarantula. Females can live over 10, 20 years old. So usually his main purpose in those 5 or 6 years is to desperately search for a mate, desperately looking for a girlfriend. And when he finds her, they mate, she lays eggs, she eats them.
Oh.
Well, she'll eat them, then she'll lay eggs. So that's why he doesn't live very
long.
Yeah, don't date tarantulas. You can't trust them, right? Now, how he walks around is he has sticky paws. And I know that, can you feel that, Carl? We'll see if he'll kind of walk a little bit. You can feel that he has a padding. And folks, what it feels like is a lot like the padding on your dog or cat's foot. And that's what helps him stick and move and not slide around. He also has little hooks at the ends of his legs, and these little hooks also help grab a hold of little tiny crevices in the tree branches or in the ground, or in this case, the little ridges on your skin. Mm. Do you have any questions about it?
Well, we've got about 10 minutes left. I'd like to meet some of the other some of your other friends
Let's get him up with us. What is he doing lifting his hat?
He wants to stay.
Sometimes
made friends.
He's very nice snake. Spider.
He
feels so comfortable, and right now, I wish you folks can see me. He has a lot of his legs up, but he's just resting his belly on my hand. Very comfortable. All right, we're going to put him back into his...
Fred. Nice to meet you, Fred.
See you later, Fred. All right, so now we're going to check out another animal, and this is going to be a reptile. Now, reptiles are cold-blooded. They have scaly skin, but they all look a little bit different. And I'm hoping, which looks like Koopa just came out. Hold him a little bit far away from you, because Koopa loves... to surprise you with a big waterfall of urine or poo.
Well, I'm used to that with your basic box turtles.
Yes.
You can do that. Grab those and pick them up.
Absolutely.
It's the same sort of thing.
Okay, so we are looking at a sulcata tortoise. This is an Africa tortoise. You find them in sub-Sahara Africa. So they love deserts. And as you can see, they blend very well in with the desert. They have a yellow, brownish, darkish black coloration to them. And that's what helps them blend in with the dirt and all the dying vegetation that's around them. Now, they are herbivores, so they eat plants, but they not only will they eat roots and like cactus and stuff like that, they love bright colors. So this particular guy is going to want to look for hibiscus and stuff, so that's his favorite food. To describe what he looks like, he's probably about 10 pounds at this point. He's probably around 5 or 6 years old, and he is going to live to be about 100 to 150 years old. So if you can imagine, he's going to get much bigger. Why don't you turn around so the camera can see his face? There you go. So he's going to get much bigger than what you're seeing right now. So once again, he's about 10 pounds.
He's heavy.
And he might be 12. What do you think, Tim?
Yeah, about 10, 15 pounds.
10, 15 pounds. And like I said, he's just 5 or 6. So imagine he started off when he hatched from his egg. He could fit in my hand. And now it's taking two of your hands and quite a bit of muscle to hold him up, right? Because he's pretty hefty.
Yeah.
But after he, with him being a reptile, cold-blooded, low metabolism, he's very slow to grow. But like I said, he's going to get up to 200 pounds, and he's going to be huge.
And the difference then, the box turtle or the turtles that we see around here in South Dakota is more the protrusions on the shell.
What a lot of people think that, Carl, but what it is there's a difference between a turtle and a tortoise. Turtles have flippers, and they spend most of their time in the water. They can go on land. They'll chill on a branch or on a big log or a rock to bask in the sun to warm up, to build energy. Tortoises do not swim around in water. They cannot swim. They have these big stumpy legs, folks, that remind you a lot of like an elephant's leg. And at the end, they have toes or claws. These claws are what helps them to dig, because remember, they like to dig for roots. They also like to dig deep holes, because they will hide underneath the ground to keep cool in the deserts. And also, they kind of do a little bit of a, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Just, he'll kind of hide underneath there for long periods of time and wait for maybe the wet season to come in. So he loves to dig. So just imagine big, stumpy, elephant-like legs with claws on them. So if he were to go in the water, drop down, he would sink and drown.
Yeah.
So he particularly gets his water not from swimming and jumping in a pool, but from the food that he eats. He gets his water.
And this is Koopa?
Yes, this is Koopa. And to describe him, his shell, too, is he's a really bumpy shell, looks kind of pyramid-y, and that is because when he was a pet, he wasn't fed a balanced diet. And so his shell didn't grow nice and smooth like it should. It grew upwards. It doesn't hurt him right now, but it will slow down his longevity. So he might live 100 years instead of 150. But make sure you, if you want to go ahead and grab our next animal, but make sure, folks, that you educate yourself on the animals that you get before you purchase them. Ask yourself, how long do they live? What do they eat? Do they like to dig up my linoleum and my carpet or my garden or tear apart my fence? Make sure you study animals before you get them as a pet. Thank you, Carl.
Okay, here we have an iguana, green iguana.
Well, I'll lift him up. Here he's
okay.
Here
you go.
All right. Let him just calm down for a second. There we go. And make sure you always get rescued animals before purchasing. I want to throw that in there. All right, so this is Wiki. Wiki is a green iguana, and he feels super famous, I bet, right now. He's watching all of you very closely. He's wanting to know what's going on, because he is a very curious little dude. This is a reptile as well, and you probably know that already. He is not full grown yet. He's around 5 or 6 years old, but he will get a little bit bigger than this. Now, iguanas are super cool, and the reason for that is not only are they herbivores, and they can swim, but they're also amazing climbers. They can climb up really high up in the trees looking for different fruits and vegetables to eat. But if they get scared, they can jump out of the tree and they can fall from 40 feet all the way down to the ground and not die. They're tough. They're built like a tank.
Wow.
So that's something that's really neat about them. They also have something on their head that you might see if you look closely. They have a clear scale on the top part of their head. We're not going to touch that or wave over it, because I like to call it a third eye. So if you can see,
it looks like a little diamond or something.
It looks like a diamond on the top part of his head, and it's clear, and that way the sun's light can hit and that scale and go straight to his brain, sending him messages. Is there shade above me or light? Because if there's shade above him, that's a harpy eagle. That's a predator. And he, because the eyes are on the side of his head, he can't always see up. So having that extra third eye really helps him to see that eagle. If it flies over him, he knows there's something over me that's going to grab me with some big talons. So then that's when he'll jump 40 feet out of the tree, or that's when he'll run and scurry down the tree. So it's really awesome adaptation for survival. And then lastly, if you look here on the side, you can see is his ears. He has ear holes. Every reptile has these. They're all great listeners, can hear very well. But he loves to swim, swim just like a Komodo dragon or an alligator or a crocodile, some water snakes. But he doesn't want to get water in there. If he got water in there, he could potentially leak into his lungs, into his throat, to his brain, who knows, and it could drown him. So he has this really thin scale that goes over his ear hole so that water doesn't get in. Isn't that cool?
Yeah. Well, we've got just about a few minutes, about 3-4 minutes left, so we've got, we should meet Julia Squeezer here before we
definitely
wind things up here.
I'm going to give Wiki back, and hopefully if he won't let go of me. Okay, we're going to go ahead and grab Julia Squeezer. Now, Julia Squeezer is a red-tailed boa from Colombia. Ooh, you are cold. And this is one of my favorite animals. He is super cool, isn't he? All right. It's about 6.5 feet tall, so probably a little bit taller than you, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, do you want to hold his tail?
Sure, just hold the tail.
Yeah, just hold his tail. He's super cool.
Wow, it feels kind of... I don't know how to describe that feeling.
It's not slimy.
No, it's not slimy.
Folks, you need to know that snakes are not slimy. They're really smooth. They actually feel exactly like your fingernails. And that is because their scales are made out of the same thing. They're made out of keratin. Same thing as your hair and fingernails. Similar as a rhino's horn, as antelope's horns, as porcupine quills. So they have those all over his body. And like I said, he's a boa. So folks, he is not venomous. He is a constrictor. And his color pattern that he has is different types of big blotches of a tan, brown, and black. And this is what helps him blend so well living up in the trees, in the rainforest and tree canopy. And this is this movement that he's doing here, this slithering, it is because he's just a huge muscle with no legs.
Well, I could feel it. I'm holding down towards the end of the tail, and for a while it was just kind of wrapped around
He can wrap around it. It's kind of, think of it like a monkey's tail. It's pretty, it's like a huge prehensile body. He can just wrap around anything. So, folks, right now he's just completely wrapped around my entire body, kind of like a belt. And this is how he would move in the tree. So I'm just kind of a big tree for him right now. And he would sit and wait and wait and wait for the food to come to him. And then when it comes to him, he will freeze. And he'll use his camouflage to hide from the predator or the prey. And then when the prey gets super close, snap! And then he uses sharp teeth. He has about 100 in his mouth that will hold the prey in place. Then he'll whip around the mouse, squeeze him. And when the mouse is taking a breath in, his last breath, because when he breathes out, the snake will squeeze with him and squeeze every last arrow, and then he'll swallow him whole. Now, these snakes only eat a couple times a month, usually just once a month. If you feed them more than that, you're overfeeding them. Mm-hmm. And that is because they have a really low metabolism. They don't need to eat much more than that.
Slowly squeeze and move around.
That's right. Isn't he cool? Did you take a look at his eye? Even his eye is camouflage, folks. You look very careful.
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that beautiful?
Looks like it blends into the skin almost.
That's right.
Like it's a marking on the skin.
And you might be wondering, why do they move their tongue the way that they do? This is actually so that he can smell. He's smelling and tasting the environment. Similar to an insect that has antlers. They're using their tongue to be like, what's around me? Is there a rat by me? Is there food I can eat? Is there a lot of moisture? So it's it just helps them to survive. Every animal, you might think they're creepy, but you know what? Snakes have an extremely important purpose on this planet, as do every single animal. So regardless of whether it's creepy or not, you should at least love and respect them, and don't just kill them because you're scared of them, because we need them.
Well, Stephanie, thanks so much for taking the time to join us on
Dakota
Midday, and good luck. And it sounds like even if things don't work out, the mutual money, other great things that are ahead for you.
Well, if you could help me out, folks, by liking my Facebook fan page, that would be amazing. So my name is Stephanie Arne, A-R-N-E. If you could like that in Wild Kingdom TV on Facebook, then you would be showing a lot of hometown community support. So thank you for that.
Well, Stephanie, thanks again for joining us.
You're welcome.
Midday, and for bringing along your friends.
Yes.
And them as well. And that's it for today's edition of Dakota Midday. Thanks to all of our guests on today's show, Karen Dunham, Captain Diane Diekman, Stephanie Arne, and Wiki Koopa, Fred, the Georges, and Julius Squeezer. Our producer from Vermilion is Stephen Zwemke from our studios at the University of Sioux Falls, Nick Poppins, Tanner Wangsness, Joy Russo, Jaden Miller, Dave Palmer, Nate Weck, Keely Boltina, and we also had help from Stephen Zwemke. Coming up tomorrow on Dakota Midday, be listening for Tech Radio with the Computer Guys. That's at noon Central, 11 Mountain on SDPB Radio. I'm Carl Gehrke. Stay tuned. Talk of the Nation is coming up next.